I'm a child of Japanese immigrants. My parents immigrated to the United States for grad school, had me and my brother, and we lived as a unit of four in America. We spoke Japanese at home, ate Japanese food, watched Japanese TV, and on Saturdays, my parents would teach my brother and I how to read and write in Japanese, even though we dreaded it every week. As we grew up and started to feel how different our home lives were from our friends, my parents explained to us that they were raising us as Japanese kids in America, which, thinking about it as an adult, it makes sense. My parents spent the majority of their lives in Japan, and they were just raising us how they were raised by their own parents. But growing up, that was just about the most confusing thing. Like, how does that even work? Am I Japanese or am I American? As soon as I learned how percentages worked, I asked my parents, what percent of me is Japanese and what percent of me is American? Because I couldn't even really understand or fathom my own ethnicity. And when they'd reply, well, you're 100% both, that would confuse me even more because as far as I could tell, that does not add up to 100 whatsoever. If you're someone who grew up between two cultures, then this might be a familiar tale to you. You get conflicting signals about who you are and who you're supposed to be. You don't know how the different pieces of your life could even fit together, and so you're unsure of how to even exist. And you don't know how to explain who you are, not just to other people, but also to yourself. These are the questions that I've had about my own identity throughout my life. High school is a fun time. It's when you start questioning who you are on this planet and who you're supposed to be. And as an Asian American girl growing up in predominantly white neighborhoods, these questions manifested in what I call my cultural identity existential crisis. You see, growing up with both Japanese and American cultures, which sometimes feel like complete opposites of each other, the context switching was intense, and it felt like I was getting flung from one side to the other constantly. So yeah, high school Miyuko agonized over this. It felt like I had to choose one or the other, which felt a lot like picking your favorite parent. And I didn't want to choose. I just had no clue how to be me and just exist. Usually people turn to role models for inspiration, but again, I lived in an area with not many other Asian people, and this was the mid-2000s. There weren't exactly that many other Asian American people I could look up to in the media. But then in 2008, in the early days of social media and online content, I found YouTube. This moment, looking back, was the beginning of a cultural moment for Asian Americans, where YouTubers like Wong Fu Productions, Ryan Higa, Kina Granis, AJ Raphael, and many more started putting themselves and their work online. As I discovered and started watching their videos, I was so empowered to see other Asian Americans share their work, music, and stories online. And their videos, which oftentimes had undertones of cultural identity, were really lighthearted, fun, and incredibly relatable. Watching them be themselves was honestly life-changing. And that's when it dawned on me. Maybe it's okay if I allow myself to just exist, you know? Maybe I didn't need to know how my two worlds were going to fit together just yet, because I was just a junior in high school after all. Maybe I didn't need to have all of the answers. Maybe I didn't need to figure out if I was just a Japanese girl growing up in America, or if I was an American girl with Japanese parents. I decided that I was just me, Miyuko, and that's the only thing I needed to define myself by for now. So then I went to college at UC San Diego. When I started, my major was undeclared because, again, deciding who I was gonna be and what I was gonna do with my life at 18 is a hard decision for probably most students. All I knew is that I wanted to find purpose in helping others. This was a value instilled in me from my parents that I really resonated with. Oh, and that I needed to be financially independent after college. As a firstborn child in my family, I really didn't want to worry my parents after graduation. After trying various STEM classes in my freshman year, by pure luck, I found computer science, which both gave me the purpose and stability that I was looking for. It's not exactly what I expected myself to be studying though, because women are heavily underrepresented in the tech industry even today. Over the next 4 years, I found that computer science was not a walk in the park. I often wondered if I'd made a mistake because I was rarely in the top half of my class grades-wise. I mean, just the imposter syndrome was so real, but I was so desperate to make this work. Every test, every programming assignment, every career fair, It felt like it was sink or swim. But honestly, I think I was able to get through it all because I had found my people at school. UCSD, for those of you who might not be familiar with the student body, has a majority Asian student population. And so for the first time in my life, I was surrounded by so many Asian Americans that I could relate to. A lot of them also had questions about identity and were studying STEM in search of fulfilling a promise to both their past, present, and future family. Sure, sometimes it was hard to not see each other as competition because the stakes were high, grades were always on a curve, and career fairs made us feel like we were all trying to grab the same seat at the table. But in between it all, we spent hours studying together, getting boba together, and then inevitably heading to the labs to do our assignments that made us wonder in the wee small hours of the morning if everything was gonna be okay. After I graduated, I continued on my path to become a software engineer. I was curious about working in Silicon Valley because it was the Hollywood of the tech industry. So after graduation, I moved there and spent the next 6 years building iOS applications. For me, starting work was a huge confidence boost for my identity. It was validating to see that my own decision to study computer science was paying off because I was using the skills that I built to contribute to something bigger than me. And that's when I started to realize that identities, in fact, could be crafted because I had worked to build this one. So, in the middle of writing this boost of confidence, I decided the time was right to fulfill one of my high school dreams, starting my own YouTube channel. In 2017, I posted my first video, A Day in the Life of a Software Engineer, where I show you what my day looks like without any talking, with some chill lo-fi music playing in the background, kind of like a modern-day Ghibli movie. I continued to make videos afterwards on nights and weekends while I worked full time and devoted my channel to helping people find their own path through the tech industry. At the beginning, I had no idea how to write, film, or edit a video, but it was through YouTube that the big questions that I had about life started to come into focus. Unlike the beginning of my software engineering career, I didn't have this expectation for it to help me gain stability in my life. So, I allowed myself to be vulnerable and make stuff to explore deep questions around purpose, identity, and adulting in general. And through that, I was able to start seeing what I'd been missing out on this whole time, the time, space, and grace to explore who I wanted to be. My software engineering career, however, was still going, and my day-to-day work revolved around building new features on apps. I got to interact with different kinds of people, use the skills that I learned in college, and encounter new programming problems every day. But a few years after I started YouTube and I started to see the impact I was making online with my videos, my software engineering career started to feel kind of stale. Like, I wasn't so sure if I wanted to pursue this path anymore. I went into this career dreaming how I can make a difference in people's lives and gaining financial independence. I was able to achieve the second part, fortunately, but it didn't really feel like I had achieved the first. I felt this purpose I had to wake up and go to work every morning was often overshadowed by revenue-focused business decisions rather than about genuinely helping others. It started to feel like my work output was the main thing that defined my value, and that just didn't sit well with me. Maybe I started to get a little jaded, but it got really hard to see what I was even doing all of this for. So then I asked myself, well, Mayuko, what is it then that you really want to do? Unlike high school Mayuko, this one had answers. I realized that I wanted to connect with people and get to know them and who they are and how they thought about life in the world. I guess, after all, I was still looking for inspiration on how to answer the question, who the heck am I? Luckily for me, I had been basically building a job for myself where I would be doing just that, content creation. But I felt a lot of resistance to embracing this new part of my life. To me, choosing to be a YouTuber was one of the riskiest career decisions I could make, because up until that point, I had made some pretty risk-averse decisions. I mean, YouTubing as a job is pretty unconventional, even by American standards, and definitely so by Japanese standards. There's even a saying in Japanese, "Terukugi wa utareru," or "the nail that sticks out gets hammered in," which warns you about deviating from the norm. Even though many signs pointed to content creation as a thing that I really wanted to do, doing so would essentially mean that I would become the nail that sticks out. And I knew I needed to challenge everything that I had worked for up until that point. the 4-year computer science degree, every job that I had, and a full-time salary with benefits. What I didn't realize, though, is just how hard it'd be. In the fall of 2019, my mental health took a deep fall. This was right after I had made my decision to go into content creation, and my brain quite literally went into panic mode. It was like, Mayuko, this is the complete opposite of everything we've worked for in the last 26 years. Like, what are you doing? It was actually a really difficult time for me. There was one particular week where the panic attacks wouldn't stop, and for about 4 months, my anxiety manifested as physical symptoms. My brain just wouldn't let me forget about the danger that came with making such a fundamental change about who I am and how I view the world. So I consistently went to therapy during this time. After a period of healing, after which I finally felt like I could breathe again, I realized that a complete value reset was necessary. So slowly, together with my therapist, I worked to challenge everything that had served me up until this point. Things like my risk-averse mindset and my own assumptions about doing creative work versus being in STEM, and my values, goals, and experiences. It took time to heal from what was one of the scariest experiences ever, but one by one, I assembled the building blocks of my life from scratch, carefully, intentionally, and compassionately. And that's led me to me here talking to you all. I survived the big jump into content creation, and I'm actually on to my second year. And while I didn't exactly come out unscuffed, I'm finding that there is ground beneath my feet. But I am me, after all. So over the last year, I've continued to explore the big questions. Who am I? What makes me me? And how can I lead a life that feels more me? Let me just say that, wow, figuring out those big life questions is hard work. No one gives you the answers, and they only give you clues like it's some cryptic puzzle to solve. Especially so if you're from a culture that doesn't have a lot of representation here in America. It's a lot of comparing conflicting signals. What does your own culture say about something versus the culture of your peers? What expectations are there from your parents versus what expectations do your friends have from their parents? In between all of the environmental signals, all of your hopes and dreams and feelings are a part of the picture too. All of that can make you wonder how you're ever supposed to be whole. From allowing myself to just exist as a young teen, to starting to explore where I fit in through college and my software engineering career, to a period in my life in which my mental health challenged me to re-examine my own values, and ultimately to rebuilding my own life and defining myself how I want to. If there's one thing I've learned through all of this, is that it's not that these conflicting signals and pieces from your life are a curse. In fact, it's a gift that you get to choose what your own life looks like. Like, you're literally the only person in your life who can take all of these pieces and figure out what it all means. And maybe when you embark on this journey and you start to realize what makes you you, you might even realize that you've actually been whole this entire time. Maybe even 200% whole. So after all this time, do I know myself a little bit better than high school Mayuko? Yeah, I'd like to think so. But would I do everything all over again, even if it meant I faced all the same challenges? Absolutely. It was hard, but like I said, no one else can do this work for me. And so getting to know myself, my values, and everything that's been a part of me has been the best thing. I think that no matter who you are, you deserve to exist, to explore who you are, to challenge your own truth, and to define who you are. Regardless of the worlds that you live between, the expectations and assumptions that other people have of you, once you realize this, you'll realize that you're the only person who can create the answers to your life that you're looking for. Piecing together your life puzzle and trying to figure out what that picture looks like, I believe, is one of life's greatest adventures.